know, gnosis. It's not the word gnosis. It's not to know by experience. It's a different Greek word, oida, O-I-D-A. It means to know certainly, confidently, almost absolutely, guaranteed. He says, I want you to know with confidence, with guarantee, with certainty, with confidence, that you, present tense, have eternal life. You may know it's the perfect verb tense again, gang. Perfect verb tense. Past action. Completed. Results continue throughout all time. Have eternal life. It's present means ongoing. Indicative, it's a statement of fact. So here's some, page five, some more arguments. Deductive arguments for eternal security. Once saved, always saved. Yes, I think so. Convinced of it. Modus ponens. It's a certain type of deductive argument that means in the mood of affirming. If P, then Q. So if proposition P is Q, then Q follows. P is true, therefore Q is true. Example, if it's raining like crazy outside, then the ground is wet. It is raining outside, therefore the ground is wet. Here's a couple of examples or a couple of paradigms. If salvation is dependent on the unchanging character of God, that's the P, then the believer is eternally secure. P, salvation is dependent on the unchanging character of God. Therefore, the believer is eternally secure. Put it another way, if the security of the believer is dependent on the character of God and the character of God never changes, then the security of the believer never changes. The security of the believer is dependent on the character of God, and the character of God never changes. Therefore, the security of the believer never changes. I'm convinced those are actually valid deductive arguments, which mean they're not only true, they actually have to be true. Two, another type of deductive argument, not in the MP format. Example, all men are mortal, or as they die. Socrates, the teacher of Plato, is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. That's just a warm-up for you to see the form. Here goes applied to this issue. The security of the believer is solely dependent on the character of God. The character of God never changes. Therefore, the security of the believer never changes. I don't think you're going to challenge statement two on me. I don't think I've got any open theists here or process theists. I don't think anybody remotely evangelical is going to question statement two. The character of God never changes. I think we're pretty convinced of that. So if you don't like my conclusion, you only have one option. You got to challenge statement one. If you don't, game over. God wins. Three, modus tollens, a deductive argument in the mood of denying. If P, then Q. Q is not true, therefore P is not true. If a believer can lose their salvation, then salvation is based on works. Salvation is not based on works. Therefore, a believer cannot lose their salvation. Another argument. If a believer can lose their salvation, then the promises of God can fail. The promises of God cannot fail. Therefore, the believer cannot lose their salvation. Third one. If the believer can lose their salvation, then eternal life is not eternal. Eternal life is eternal. Therefore, the believer cannot lose their salvation. Now, my last degree that I got is philosophy. I got a master's in philosophy from Talbot Seminary. And so I do not have the ability not to think philosophically anymore. It's impossible. It won't happen. Because now I got some new data, some new information, some new terminology, and I evaluate everything that I hear and see from a philosophical standpoint. Gets me into trouble when I'm watching movies with my family. Because I want to analyze everything, and they're like, Papa, just watch it. And I want to analyze it. They don't. They just want to be entertained. That's our culture. But I'm not interested in being entertained only. I want to think with my brain. I want to analyze things. And most of what the culture is selling actually is not true or right. So, once saved, always saved? Absolutely. Why? Because it's dependent on the character of God. Because it's dependent upon the promise of God. Because salvation is a gift and totally of grace. It's not based upon you or me. It's based upon God. Not anything you can do. Yeah, but what about What about John 15, verse 6? If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as, that's a simile in literature, a simile, is thrown away as a branch and dries up. And they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. My analysis, a lack of abiding shows a lack of relationship. It's interesting how Paul changed the pronoun here in this text. Before and after, he uses personal pronouns. You, 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 you. And in verse 6, he changes it to an impersonal pronoun. Third person, if, hypothetical, anyone. He's not talking about them. He's talking about a hypothetical situation. So if somebody doesn't abide, that's proof that you're not a believer. You don't have to abide to be a believer, but the proof of being a believer is abiding. John 10, 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. You don't become a sheep by following. Following is not the way you get to be a sheep. Following is the result of being a sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Following is the byproduct. Following is not the means to become. Following is the result of. John 10, 27, that was. It's like a branch. It's like a branch that dries up. What's the purpose of branches on fruit trees? Collect space? Yeah, to produce fruit. If it doesn't produce fruit, you prune it. You get rid of it. But it's still useful for firewood. It still has a purpose. It'll still give you warmth. But it hasn't achieved its primary purpose, bearing fruit. 11:22 of Romans. Behold, then, the kindness and severity of God. To those who fell, severity, but to you, God's kindness, if you continue in his kindness, otherwise you also will be cut off. Oh, see? See, if you don't continue walking with God, you're going to be cut off from a relationship. No, I'm sorry, it won't work because it's not applying to individuals. If you read the context of Romans 11, he's talking about an entire group of people, Jews or Gentiles. And he's saying to them as a group of people, you keep on snubbing your nose at me, I'm going to quit dealing with you. In fact, that's why you and I as Gentiles got into the deal. In part, the Jews kept on rejecting the message, and Paul says, man, I'm done with you guys. I'm done with you Jews. I'm done with you guys. I'm going to the Gentiles. So he's not talking about individuals. He's talking about a whole group of people. Third, Matthew 7, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name cast out demons, in your name perform many miracles, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Well, these guys were Christians, weren't they? No, they weren't. Jesus says, I never knew you. Compare that with John 10, 27, where he says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them. He uses the aorist verb tense here. It means point in time action. There was never a point in time that I knew you. I never knew you. He didn't say, well, you know, I knew you once, but you were such a jerk. I don't know you anymore. No, he says, there was never a point in time that I knew you. Were they religious? Yeah. Were they involved in spiritual things? Yeah. Were they doing things in the name of Jesus? Yes. Did they know him personally? No. I never knew you. For the issue of perseverance or endurance, these are major references. It's not exhaustive. Perseverance in the English is the noun form. Endurance is the verb form, but they're the same word, only the noun and verb forms. I don't have time to unpackage this, but I did want to make the statement of Hebrews 10:39 that says, but we are not like those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to the persevering of the soul. So my closing statement on number 4 is this. You'll have to write in a word because I typoed. Those who are saints will persevere. So perseverance, do I have to persevere to be a saint? No. If I'm a saint, I will persevere, and God will give me the energy and the faith to continue to persevere.